نحمده ونستعينه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. الحمد لله وحده صدق وعده ونصر عبده وأعز جنده وهزم الأحزاب وحده. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله رب واحد وإله واحد له الأمر من قبل وله الأمر من بعد ويومئذ يفرح المؤمنون بنصر الله ينصر من يشاء. وأشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم عبده ورسوله. لقد جاءكم رسول من أنفسكم عزيز عليه ما عنتم حريص عليكم بالمؤمنين رؤوف رحيم. فإن تولوا فقل حسبي الله لا إله إلا هو عليه توكلت وهو رب العرش العظيم. من يطع الله ورسوله وأولي الأمر من المؤمنين فلا مضل له ومن يعص الله ورسوله وأولي الأمر من المؤمنين فلا هادي له. ومن يتوكل على الله فإن الله على كل شيء قدير. ومن يعتصم بالله يهدي قلبه ومن يستغفر الله يجد الله غفورا رحيما. أما بعد, brothers and sisters, committed Muslims, it is our intent to follow up meanings in the Quran that have long lapsed, particularly as they relate to an active segment of the population that has come a long way from its original positions during the time of Allah's Prophet. May Allah's peace and blessings be upon him and his. To the time period that we are in and the positions that they occupy currently, we reminded ourselves in previous khutbas of Allah's words as they reflect our own incapacity, our vulnerabilities. Allah says, وَمَا لَكُمْ فِي الْمُنَافِقِينَ فِئَتَيْنِ وَاللَّهُ أَرْكَسَهُمْ بِمَا كَسَبُوا. What is wrong with you having two attitudes, two mindsets when it comes to surface Muslims and core kafirs? People, individuals who appear to be Muslims but whose internal motivation is a kafir one. This is a fact of life, brothers and sisters. Ittaqullah. Be conscious of Allah when it comes to this fact of life. Alam tara ila alladhina nafaqu. Another ayah that we covered. Alam tara ila alladhina nafaqu. يقولون لإخوانهم الذين كفروا من أهل الكتاب. Do you not consider those who are involved nation. And there are human beings, active, prevalent, having a say and a control over our lives, who meet this description exactly. أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِينَ نَافَقُوا pretending iman and intending kufr. يقولون لإخوانهم الذين كفروا من أهل الكتاب, as they express to their fraternal extension of those who are deniers of Allah from within people of scripture. This is not very hard to follow. Allah's words are to the point, exact meanings, no room for misunderstanding. ألم تر إلى الذين نافقوا يقولون لإخوانهم الذين كفروا من أهل الكتاب لئن أخرجتم لنخرجن معكم. This type of communication that goes back and forth between those who are theatrical Muslims but who are dead serious kafirs, this line of communication has been exposed by Allah. They do all they can to classify it, to shroud it in secrecy, to put it away from the public eye, to bury it behind closed doors. They can do all they want. If we have an understanding of what Allah is telling us, these two types of people, the Munafiqin and the Kuffar, should be very clear to us. But it happens that we have a portion of clarity when it comes to the Kafirs, but we don't have any clarity at all when it comes to the Munafiqin. This is the area that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has worked on in His everlasting book, which is in our physical possession. Nothing of it, not one letter, not one phonetic has been changed. The meaning is crystal clear as it was delivered the first day to Allah's Prophet. عَلَيْهِ أَفْضَلُ الصَّلَاةُ وَأَتَمُّ عَلَيْهِ أَفْضَلُ الصَّلَاةُ وَأَتَمُّ السَّلَامُ. Exactly as it was over 14 centuries ago. So why can't we see these people around us? We, on the other hand, happen, or it appears, that we place ourselves in defensive positions. The accusations that come at us come from all directions. And they are reinforced by this fifth column that dwells among us. Look how Muslims are fanatics, intolerant. Muslims are terrorists. Muslims are, we don't have to repeat this, they say it so many times, everyone knows what they are saying. But what we don't understand and what we can't see very clearly are the purveyors of these lies. The ones who try to make it stick among us. Because we don't have a vision. We don't have a public mind. We don't have a common sense that can point to these munafiqeen and stand them out as the traitors that they are. Let us now relocate ourselves into the company of Allah's Prophet. alayhi salatu wassalam. Allah's Prophet at the time had power, authority, jurisdiction. He was the ruler, he was the governor, he was the decision maker. This is the primary image of Allah's Prophet that we should be relating to compensate for the fissures that have developed within our own communities and our own societies. Allah's Prophet had to deal with these types of characters. What did he do? Did he make believe that, oh, none of them are around? Everyone who expresses the Shahada is an authentic Muslim? No. This is the type of attitude and the type of thoughts that we have today. Everyone who expresses La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, is, as far as this public notion is concerned, everyone who says so is a full-fledged Muslim. When Allah's Prophet had to prepare for the revenge of the Meccan mushriks, they were defeated at Badr, and now they were coming to Al-Madinah to settle their score with Allah's Prophet and with the struggling Muslims with him. What happens at this time? What happens is that there is a category of people that solicited Allah's words. Words that have become a matter of our dedication to Allah. Understanding these Quranic words have become a form of worship, to use a word that we try to avoid, by which we approach Allah. What do? Do you fight an enemy in the open, or do you draw him in to the vicinity of or the security of a city, and you take him on in urban warfare? What do? And Allah's Prophet presented this to you and me. What do? There was an opinion among us. Let us try to put ourselves in that condition. In those days, there was an opinion upon us that said, no, we don't want to fight the enemy in an open area. We want to fight an enemy here, because in the city, because that is to our advantage. Let us try to rethink why some people said something like that, even though this was the opinion of Allah's Prophet himself. But were they sincere to Allah's Prophet? Ibn Ubay, Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, the character that comes out very clearly, even though we can check ourselves and not identify the scores and the hundreds of others who are with him. This wasn't Allah Azza wa Jal wasn't revealing ayat in the Quran. Hundreds of ayat in the Quran that only deals with one person. He's revealing hundreds of ayat in the Quran that are dealing with human deviation, human social deviation. He said, O Prophet of Allah, we never go out and meet. This is what they were telling him. This is how they were speaking to him. If we are going to go out and meet the enemy in an open land, most likely we're going to be defeated. We don't want to do that. We want to take advantage of the territory and the terrain and the structures and the protection that are offered to us when we stay inside Al-Madinah. Now, with hindsight, we can rethink this. and with all the other elements that describe these types of people. Let us take a closer look at this proposition, this suggestion. Number one, do these people really want to sacrifice their lives? Or do they want to hide their true identity? Because if you go out to an open battlefront, everyone's going to know the participation, the enthusiasm, the sacrifices that are expended there. But if you stay inside a city, you can claim you did a lot of heroic acts, and who's going to know? There are streets, there are alleys, there are dwellings, there are houses, there are structures, there are many things. So these people, when you look at their behavior, beginning with that incident all the way until Allah's Prophet passed away, you will find that they were trying, number one, to dodge their responsibilities. Number two, not to sacrifice their life and their limb for the cause of Allah. And number three, to act on behalf of the external enemy. Because you also don't know if you're inside a city and there's this type of warfare going on. These munafiqeen can be killing Muslims and the Muslims would not know. These are events that never took place because the Prophet, once he made up his mind, set forth to go outside of Medina to Uhud and take on the mushriks of Mecca there. So we can only rethink these details. But what happened after that? On their way, this Islamic force on its way to Uhud, one third of it breaks away. Now, with all these accusations coming at us, you feel it. If you just listen to what's being said in the world around how intolerant Muslims are, if Muslims are going to establish an Islamic state and society, how fanatic it will be and all of this. All of these accusations coming our way. Doses of them. Heavy doses and light doses from every direction, okay? Let us look at this instance. In today's militaries, these kafirs, they have militaries and they have wars and they make decisions and all of this. How, we ask these people who are throwing accusations at us, we ask them, if one third of their military refused to go to a war or a battle, how would they treat that military? Court-martial them, and the harshest punishment would be meted out to them. Look at here. This is an area, this shows you how confident and how absolutely resolute the Muslims were in their reliance upon Allah. One third of this Islamic force abandoned, left, deserted. What do the Muslims do? They said, we're going to go back to Medina and court-martial these people. Like these would do over here. Or does this not display the type of tolerance that Muslims have, even to those who have gone to this extreme in their treachery to Islam and to the Prophet and to Allah and to the committed Muslims? Talk about, you know, in an Islamic society, there's not going to be any freedom. What more, how much more freedom can we express than the freedom that was given to these types of individuals? When Abdullah ibn Abdullah ibn Ubay, the son of this munafiq, who was going to be crowned the royal of Yathrib, Yathrib, before the advent of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when his son returned severely injured from this military encounter, this Munafiq goes to his son. He said, I told you, son, you shouldn't have gone out there. That was an immature decision. Muhammad was listening to some zealot youth. There was no need for all of this. And what happened after Uhud was the highest pitch propaganda by these foul mouths of Munafiqin in Al-Madinah against now a battered body of Muslims returning from an inconclusive military affair. This Munafiq, the type of character that today's Muslims have grown oblivious of. When Allah's Prophet, alayhi wa alihi afdalu salati wa salam, when he used to give the khutbah during Friday, on Fridays, between the two khutbahs, in that pause, Ibn Ubay would stand up and he would say to the crowd of all the Muslims there listening to the khutbah during that time period, here we are honored to have the Messenger of Allah among us, within us. فانصروه وعزروه واسمعوا له وأطيعوه. These are his words, the words of this type of character. Help him, support him, listen to what he says and obey him. This is what he's saying to the Muslim crowd. Here is where we have a clash between the technical fiqhi mind that says, من لغى فلا جمعة له. Whoever speaks out during the khutbah has no Jummah. Of course, this character wasn't speaking when Rasulullah was speaking, but he was speaking between the two khutbahs. In today's literal fiqhi mind that has ossified throughout the centuries, if someone between the two khutbahs today was going to stand up and make a remark amounting to a sentence or two, they tell him, you have violated your khutbah or your jumu'ah or your salah. That's what they would say. No one stood up to this character before Uhud. Remember, he was saying this before the Muslims went out to Uhud. And before he proved what side of the issue he is on. After Uhud, he wanted to continue. He thought the world was the same place. Now, he also thought that he could get more credibility for this. Because look, his opinion was to fight inside Medina for the wrong purposes and for the wrong ends. And so he wanted to continue this behavior. So the khutbah after Uhud, between the pause between the two khutbahs, he stands up and he wants to say the same thing. All the Muslims who were around told him, sit down. We have heard, I'm just paraphrasing it, we have heard enough and we know who you are. Characters get exposed. The Muslim public opinion is strengthened by its sacrifices and its struggle. After they struggled and they sacrificed at Uhud, after they were bleeding, this was in the immediate aftermath of Uhud, he himself felt when he wanted to speak that public opinion, all of it, was against his words, even though what was he saying? What was his words? He was saying, we are honored to have Rasulullah among us. should assist him. We should offer him support and victory. We should listen to what he is telling us, and we should obey what he's telling us to do. At that time, the Muslims, their internal mind was saying, and Allah knows best, can't you hear, you Munafiq, can't you hear what you're saying? Rasulullah, he was the one who was telling us to go out to Uhud. You're telling us to listen and obey him. What did you do? Did you listen and obey him? And there were people who went up to Allah's Prophet and they told him, let us finish him off. Let us get rid of this person. This person, even though he was involved in the psychological and the social warfare against the Muslims, but he did not put himself directly in a military position that would have had him forfeit his life. It didn't happen. It didn't come to that. So in the meantime, what does that mean? In Muslim societies, we don't have any freedoms. But we're not going to be able to develop an argument for liberty and freedom if we are not aware of the social reality and component of an Islamic society that was put together by Allah's Prophet and those around him. And these munafiqeen, incidentally, they did not just disappear after these events in the first years in Al-Madinah. They continued even up to the last battle that the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam attended at Tabuk. There was about 80 of them. Once again, history books are silent. We want to know who these 80 were. But this is yet another void in our mind. We're not, though, responsible for that generation. There were people who were responsible there. We are responsible for our generation now. If we take these meanings and then try to focus them on the individuals and the people and the decision makers around in today's world, this is our responsibility. We have to identify who these munafiqeen are. In the time of Allah's Prophet, these munafiqeen didn't have power. They were not there making decisions for the Muslims. Allah's Prophet saw to it that they were not there making decisions for the rest of the Muslims. But that was a day, and today's another day. Right now, they have been promoted to positions of authority. They are the statesmen, they are the legislators, they are people who are in control of the media and whatever is said in public. They're all around the place. Why? Because we are not understanding what Allah Azza wa Jal is telling us. When the Muslims, once again, in one of the most critical times after Uhud, which was the siege of Al-Madinah, by the combined forces of shirk and kufr in Arabia, what happened then? Muslims were inside. Remember the munafiqeen when they wanted to fight the first time around? They were enthusiastic about fighting inside. Well, now the mushriks are on the outskirts of Al-Madinah. They're coming inside, or they're threatening to come inside Al-Madinah and fight the Muslims there. The munafiqeen were not saying, this is our day now. We're going to prove that now, if we have them fight vicinity of Al-Madinah were going to finish them off. No. At this time, the Prophet of Allah was telling the Muslims, it's only a matter of a short time and we are going to have the keys for the Kaaba. And we are going to inherit the dominion of Kisra and Qaisar, the kings of Persia and the Romans. Imagine the condition the Muslims were in. They're threatened. Here they are. They're not secure in their own selves, in their own home. And how do the munafiqs behave in this context? One of them, he quips, he says the following, look, this person, and this is in reference to Allah's Prophet, this person is promising Mecca and Persia and Byzantium. He's promising all of these are big words. And look at these Muslims, as if he's not one of them. Look at these Muslims. They're not even secure to go and take a leak. This is how these individuals come out. In today's conditions, don't Muslims at many times, in many places, don't they feel this mortal threat to their existence? Don't we feel it to our existence? And if Rasulullah's voice was speaking to us today, he'll probably say, and Allah knows better than we do, he'll probably say, it's not going to be far away. And the Kaaba is going to be liberated. And all of these superpower structures are going to be coming, crumbling down. And you're going to be moving in and filling the vacuum. Today's mind that is overtly Islamic and covertly kafir, they say, look at this, what are you talking about? We Muslims, we don't stand a chance. You're dreaming. They would tell Allah's Prophet, you are dreaming. And they're telling the Muslims who are on the path of Allah's Prophet, you're unreal. You're imagining things. And all of this, where do we get our staying power? From where do we draw our confidence? Granted, there are a lot of forces that are teaming up against this Islamic self-determination in the world. More than we can count. So in the middle of all of this, like in the middle of all of that, in those times, from where did the staying power come from? How did the Muslims draw their inspiration? It came from Allah, Jalla wa Ala, from these words. But these words will not move us forward if we decide to close our minds and not look at human beings with the light that comes to us from Allah. قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ نُورٌ وَكِتَابٌ مُبِينٌ يَهْدِي بِهِ اللَّهُ مَنِ اتَّبَعَ رِضْوَانَهُ سُبُلَ السَّلَامِ. This is the world. These are the facts. Human beings who are around, with whom we should be interacting with this light and knowledge that dwells in our hearts and in our minds from Allah. These munafiqeen displayed themselves many times. And the Muslims had enough confidence in Allah. They were sure of themselves in the company of Allah that none of these shenanigans around them influenced them a bit on their course to Allah. they set out on this journey, and whatever was going to come their way on this path was not going to cause them to turn back or to turn away. فما لكم في المنافقين فئتين والله أركسهم بما كسبوا أتريدون أن تهدوا من أضل الله. And in the other ayah, ألم تر إلى الذين نافقوا يقولون لإخوانهم الذين كفروا من أهل الكتاب لئن أخرجتم لنخرجن معكم. At the time of the siege of Al-Medina, these munafiqeen would come to Allah's Prophet saying, look, our homes are exposed. We'd like to go and protect our residences, our dwellings. And Allah described those who were coming to Allah's Prophet as coming with excuses, because they want, right now they wanted to be dismissed from their military responsibilities, even though, remember, just a few years ago in Uhud, they were intent on fighting the enemy in Al-Madinah. Now the enemy is right there on the perimeters of Al-Madinah, and they want to go back into their homes. Today, if you can make the transition, today we have similar circumstances, we have similar people, we have a duplicate human nature, and we have a repetition of this scenario. But you and I are not going to be able to see it if we are not looking through the Quran and through the Sunnah. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ودعوه سبحانه وأنتم على يقين بالإجابة وتوبوا إلى الله إن الله تواب رحيم. الحمد لله الذي هدى صلى الله وسلم على سيدنا المصطفى وعلى آله وصحبه أولي النهى والتقى. Brothers and sisters, committed Muslims, today these characters who were under an intensive Islamic heightened consciousness in Al-Madinah, right now they have broken loose. These munafiqeen, there's no longer an Islamic consciousness, an Islamic social consciousness, there's no longer an Islamic authority that can expose them. So now they've become the kings and they've become the presidents. This is something that did not happen in the time of Allah's Prophet. Munafiqeen did not come rulers and governors in the time of Allah's Prophet. But now we have them as such. That's how they're behaving now. And when they did not have power, their hearts and their psychology was located with the kafirs and the mushriks. Imagine now that they have power that relies upon the mushriks and the kafirs. And we still can't see them. We still can't identify them. There is a flaw in our relationship with Allah, Jalla Sha'nuh. When He is giving us all that is required to uncover these traitors and these betrayers, these false Muslims, and we are not able to do so. at no other time have the Munafiqin and the Kafirs locked hands and combined strategies and forces as they have done today. Where is the Islamic consciousness about all of this? Where is Islamic public opinion about all of this? It's not that Muslims are not doing anything. No, there are. We should not for one instance think that there are not committed Muslims who are on a path, and for that matter, a war path to Allah. Yujahiduna fi sabilillah. They are there. You are either with them, or you are drifting and consequentially on the side of Allah's enemies. من المؤمنين رجال صدقوا ما عاهدوا الله عليه فمنهم من قضى نحبه ومنهم من ينتظر وما بدلوا تبديلا. Of the committed Muslims, there are men who are honest and who honor their word with Allah. Some of them have gone ahead, they've passed on. And some of them are in anticipation, they are waiting. But in the interim, they have not vacillated. They have not retreated from their positions. And they have not entertained doubts about their course of action. من المؤمنين رجال صدقوا ما عاهدوا الله عليه فمنهم من قضى نحبه ومنهم من ينتظر وما بدلوا تبديلا. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه ولا تجعله ملتبسا علينا واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. ربنا عليك توكلنا وإليك أنبنا وإليك المصير. ربنا افتح بيننا وبين قومنا بالحق وأنت خير الفاتحين. اللهم انصرنا بالحق. اللهم انصر الحق بنا. اللهم كن معنا ولا تكن علينا. اللهم بك نحاول وبك نصاول وبك نقاتل. ربنا أفرغ علينا صبرا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. ربنا صل على محمد وآل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم. ربنا بارك على محمد وآل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. ومن أظلم ممن منع مساجد الله أن يذكر فيها اسمه وسعى في خرابها أولئك ما كان لهم أن يدخلوها إلا خائفين. لهم في الدنيا خزي ولهم في الآخرة عذاب عظيم. إن الله يأمركم أن تؤدوا الأمانات إلى أهلها وإذا حكمتم بين الناس أن تحكموا وَقُومُوا بِالْعَدْلِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ نِعِمَّا يَعِظُكُمْ بِهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا وَلَذِكْرُ اللَّهِ أَكْبَرُ وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ مَا تَصْنَعُونَ وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ